Yes, so welcome. My name is Arno Doonstra, and I will present a research I did into concurrent programming. In order to do this, I will lecture a bit about some of the challenges we are facing. Does everybody know what concurrent programming is? Yeah?
Yeah.
So, just to elaborate a little bit, we have computational sequential programming, which is what we do mostly nowadays, or still. Then we have concurrent programming, which is about programming when things are happening simultaneously. And there's also parallel programming, which is when you do things simultaneously as well, but it's the same operation. I'm not going to talk about parallel programming. So, concurrent programming is already being researched for decades. By pseudoscientists. My research was specifically into enabling concurrent programming for people who are not necessarily computer scientists. So I have specifically focused on creative coding. So I will begin with explaining what creative coding is. I will then talk about why we need concurrent programming. And we will then elaborate a bit about some of the mental challenges. And then I will finish off with the proposed framework and its findings. So, but please interrupt me if you have any questions or if you want to want me to elaborate a bit on the topic. I have no idea what everybody's background is, but I know concurrency is one of the most difficult topics in computer science. So don't hesitate to ask. Does anybody know what creative coding is?
No.
So, creative coding is just regular programming. However, it's with the aim of being expressive or artistic instead of being functional. So there is not much difference in programming or creative coding or creative programming. It's just a different context. It was started somewhere in the 60s, from 1968. The Compost Project, some scientists and artists working together to create works by using the computer. I personally like Pieter Struijten, famous from the Dutch poststamp. But he was very early in adopting the computer for his work. Then we got the Commodore 64, which enabled a lot of people to program. And there's a whole scene involved around the demo scene. Does anybody know the demo scene? Demos?
It exists still.
Yeah, it's very much alive. But it's very hardcore. Many artists are nowadays embracing the computer. So they want something done, and nowadays this is often with the help of the computer. And if you want the help of the computer, you eventually you have to program it. So I can show a few examples if you like. We have about, well, I'm gonna do it anyway. It's the nicest stuff I have to show anyway, so. So, for example, the modern demo scene. So this is live from a demo scene compo. I really like to show this because it's a very involved scene of people getting really enthusiastic about some algorithms, doing really nice visual and audio stuff. Nice thing about this is demos, this is a mesh of coders, and they are limited by creating an executable of 4 kilobytes. And it's really amazing what they produce. So I find it highly inspirational. If you should look it up on YouTube. Yeah, it's really impressive. But We have some really nice artists nowadays. I really like this one. So this is a Japanese artist doing projections into space, but very intense. I really like his work. What he's doing is really on the hardware level of a projector, and you can just walk around in it. But this, I find this a very typical example of new media art. So yeah, we don't have really nice audio. So, I don't know if anybody's familiar with Creative Coding Frameworks. I have some screenshots here. This is pure data, mostly audio, data flow, programming. You have processing, also from the makers of the Arduino. And below it's from Blender, which you can also use to program stuff. Any questions so far about Creative Coding? So, I consider myself a creative coder, and I have often encountered a certain problem for which this research was looking for a solution. Well, not specifically for the problem, but in general. So I will illustrate a project I've worked on. So, this is an installation made for a festival in Groningen, and it's a wall of about 7 meters wide, full of mason jars, wegflessen in the Netherlands. Mm. And these mason jars, they contain the memories of the people visiting the festival. And every memory is in the form of a light. So people had an application on their mobile phone, and they could just capture photographs or other stuff from the festival. And if they would go to the wall, they could just swipe it into a wall. And I don't know if you can see it in this specific shots, but all these lights, they move very smoothly in the. They just float around in the jars. But when we had about 2,000 memories, they would start moving jittery. So that was the problem. And that was caused by this. You understand what I mean? So the processors weren't fast enough to calculate all the movements for all the lights, and that was caused by only one core being used. So our approach to constructing these floating lights was a very traditional approach, but it was incapable of utilizing all the CPUs. So this is what we'll dive into. So in this graph you can see CPU trends, and the green line is the transistor count, and the dark blue line is the processor speed. And as you can see around 2003, that it's flattening. So computer manufacturers, they cannot make faster CPUs anymore. It's physically impossible, well, unless you make it very hot. And instead they are building multi-core CPUs. I expect this is nothing new here. What might be new is that CPUs are getting slower again, because it's more power efficient to switch off cores than lowering the CPU speed. So in the future we even see more cores. To predict that we have more cores to program and with lesser, which are less fast. So therefore we need to program multiple processors, and this proved to be very difficult, and I found out myself. So it's even that difficult that some scientists say it's too difficult for humans. But luckily, computer science, they don't give up so easily. So they do a lot of research. And but not all the solutions they come up with make it easier. Or if they do, they often alienate from current practices. So and then you end up with languages like Erlang or whatever. Well, one of the main characteristics of concurrency is that it requires a very different thought process. Traditionally, we think about the sequences of operations and that we can predict about it, but with concurrent programming, you have to add thinking about all possible combination of sequences to determine what should not happen in order to prevent conflicts. And that's a very, very hard mental process. So, well, what are the scientists saying? I'm not going to cover all the scientists, I just picked up some of the famous ones. Sutter is from 2003, it's often cited as one of the first who talked about this. His article, Free Lunch is Over, is very famous, and he warns that we not going to buy new CPUs or faster CPUs anymore, hence the free lunch is over. He raises the question that it's very difficult, concurrent programming, but he expects it will be very natural in the future. Well, this was over 10 years ago. Then we had Edward Lee, the problem with threats, and he's saying, well, it's too difficult for humans. And in his paper, he describes programming threads, the low-level building blocks of concurrent programming, are too difficult because they are very difficult to understand. It's very hard to predict the consequences of the events of threads, and their progress is also very difficult to predict. So, and he says it should only be touched by experts. So, just as an illustration, example, we have three threads, A, B, and C, and they'll print boo, ba, or ba. So what do you expect would be the outcome?
Let's
assume we have the best I.O. implementation.
Yes. So when you want at this particular moment.
Yeah, yes, exactly. Okay. We have some experts in the audience. So this could be the output, but this could be the output as well. And to make it even worse, this could be the output. Yeah. So, but you cannot tell in advance. So you really, And this is just an illustration of the difficulty. So, well, Lee says concurrent programming is too difficult for humans and it should only be touched by experts. That's not very promising. And then we have Helly and Shavit. This is often found in computer science classes as a study material. And they deem it essential to fundamentally understand the computational limits. And to really fundamentally understand concurrent computability. In a way, they support Sutter that, well, if we just study hard enough, we will master this. So, we have some scientists saying, well, this is only material for experts, and we have scientists that say, eventually we will master it if we try hard enough. So, but it's important to note that we mostly regard concurrent computing, at least computer scientists do, from the classical sequential computational perspective. However, computational model is also an abstraction of the computer. And that enables us to reason about the computer using logic. So there's nobody reasoning about the computer using varying voltages, is there? I hope not. But using the computational paradigm has worked really well for us, and we've seen enormous advancements in technology. But when we're dealing with concurrency, this paradigm, this perspective, is challenging us. Some scientists say that our existing knowledge is responsible for the central mindset, which is associated with the computational paradigm. Because we really like to organize things centrally, and we also have been quite successful in doing so. However, it is expected that this is going to change once we are surrounded by more decentralized systems. So the internet is a very good example of a decentralized system. Perhaps even nature is a very good example of something that's not organized centrally. Perhaps we needed to reform politics. But then again, who other than computer scientists are reasoning about the computer from this sequential computational paradigm? I don't know. I don't know if you do, but if I work at the computer, all these things are happening at once. I'm downloading, I'm listening to music, messages pop in. I cannot really explain all this the way I explain how I build a program. So perhaps we need a new paradigm. And Stein is a scientist that even argues that, now I have to quote her, some of computational central dogma blinds us to some of the truths of modern computer science. So she argues for a computation as interactions paradigm. And this is illustrated in this diagram. This is sequential, the traditional approach. And she proposes this model in which entities, they communicate with each other, and the program is the result of all these interactions amongst entities. So even Sutter and Lee, they argued for higher level programming. And Edward Lee is also nowadays involved in coordination languages, which I deem very promising. So as an advice, this is perhaps an interesting topic if you want to know more about it, but I'm not going to cover coordination languages. Another topic is transactional memory, which is a lot of things are happening around that. I'm also not going to cover that one. I'm not really interested in transactional memory because it's still encapsulates sequential thinking. I really like to see how we can do this concurrent thinking mentally. So I'm not going to go in that, but like I said in the beginning, I'm focusing on creative coders, which is more pragmatic, very practical, less theoretical. Therefore, I was looking for the most intuitive paradigm, low-level concurrent paradigm, and I found message passing to be the one that's most intuitive, simply because you have to send a message first before you can receive it. Hence, it prevents concurrent conflicts, which I find so simple that everybody should be able to understand that. So, small recap. From a centralized mindset, concurrent programming is difficult. We might need a paradigm shift in order to fully harvest modern CPUs. And Stein suggested a paradigm of interacting entities, which might suit better. And that's what I'm going to explore further. Is there anybody that thinks programming threads is really easy?
Can be.
Well, if you don't mind bugs.
If you don't mind bugs. Indeed. Well, then it's anything.
As long as it's a small scale and the interactions are limited.
As long as it's embarrassingly parallel.
Yes,
then it's very easy.
Yeah, there's lots of problems that work well with. And I think also generally you said when interactions are low, well-defined.
And indeed, the problems, they arise when they have to communicate. Threads have to cooperate. That's the most difficult part. So indeed, in concurrent programming, you talk about inherently serial problems until embarrassing parallel, and both are quite easy. Inherently serial, you cannot do concurrent, and embarrassing embarrassingly parallel, you can do fully concurrent because they don't interact, and somewhere in the middle, that's where the challenge is. So, but I've conducted a survey to at least get some more data about this, and so I've conducted this survey in typical creative coding communities, and I asked what about people's experience programming just regularly, sequentially, that's the blue colors, and then programming with threads, and those are the red colors. And you can see, well, the horizontal axis is the difficulty from 1 to 5, and you can see that programming with threads experienced more difficult, so that confirms what some scientists say. So, I already mentioned Stein, this computer's interaction paradigm, and well, we've taken this paradigm and designed a framework around it. And well, we've just taken some typical computer science patterns. We've used the actor model, which is also a current model. And inside the actor, we use a reactor pattern to have an application. And actors communicate using messages, message passing paradigm. And these messages we refer to as signals. So Stein talks about entities, and I talk about actors. And actors are just small sequential entities. So the framework relies on message passing, which is one of the key concepts of concurrent programming. So this framework can be applied to three scenarios. The first one is the most easy one, because we already utilize multiple processes if we can divide a program to multiple programs. So we just use separate processes, and then the operating system will divide them to processes. But we then just need to communicate between those processes, which is limited to copy only. So that's mostly to talk about inherently serial to embarrassing parallel. This is more the embarrassing parallel part of the problem. So then we have the second scenario. That's actually just the same as the first, only now we talk about threads. We're not using separate processes, but separate threads. And the benefit of this is that we can just have a very fast data exchange, because we can just hand over data. We don't have to copy it. And then the third scenario is for parallel programming, because we can just clone actors and let them do the same stuff in a typical parallel programming setup. I'm not going to focus on 3 and 1. 3 is a bit more specific, and in my opinion, much easier. But 2 is the most interesting scenario and the most challenging. So this framework is the prototype we built was done in Python. So this is a very simple code example. It's just using an object-oriented approach. And I don't know if people are familiar with setup and update methods, but these are found in almost all creative coding frameworks. The setup method is sort of the constructor, and the update method is called every application iteration. So if you run this at 60 frames per second, the update method is called 60 times per second, for example. So you can register variables, named variables, and I'll explain that a bit more in a bit. And if you want to emit a signal about this variable, you can use the emit signal method. So I said, this is still sequential traditional programming, and text-based, but you have to imagine, okay, thanks. You have to imagine this is, if you have a lot of actors, then you will be challenged about how do you coordinate everything between those actors. And therefore we have built an actor editor. And that's just a tool that visualizes how all these actors relate. And you can also orchestrate them. You can modify what the relations are. So it's not only visualizing how your program is made up, but you can also influence it. So if this is the code example, this is the my first actor, then you will see it here. That's the my first actor, just shows up in the actor editor. So a little time left. Let me just quickly explain what we did. So we invited a group of creative coders, and we introduced them to the framework, and we gave them three tests they had to work on to find a solution for. And then we were interested in whether the subject would understand the problem, and they would come up to, able to come up with a solution, and how difficult they would find it. So the first test was the we called the painter screen. They had to have multiple painters paint on a single canvas, and if you know about graphics programming, this is challenging because only one thread can access the graphic card. The second one was a typical computer science problem, the dining philosopher's problem. So five philosophers sit around the table, and they all have a bowl of rice and a chopstick left and right, and then they had to share the chopsticks, and then you had to make a program without starving one philosopher or creating a deadlock if everybody was waiting for the left chopstick. And then we had a third test, and that was about shared memory. You were given the source code of an application that showed the webcam image, but it was only doing one thumbnail, and then you had to write a program that made multiple thumbnails and do some modification on the image. And this test was devised to introduce shared memory. We've done these tests in a single day. It wasn't strange that people didn't finish their programs, but it wasn't required. But subjects were ran into three challenges during this test. First, they had to understand the framework. Then they had to wrap their head around the assignment. And if they weren't familiar with the dining philosopher's problem, that was quite challenging. And finally, they had to design a program or a solution for their assignment. So this diagram shows how difficult people would find the tests. And the most difficult one was indeed the dining philosopher's problem. And it's important to note that we interviewed all the subjects, but we found no reason that they were having difficulty with concurrency. And when we asked the same question, like showed in the earlier diagram, about how difficult they would find traditional programming and programming with threads and with this framework, the blue colors are the traditional programming, the red colors programming with threads, and the green colors were the framework. Then at least they found it easier than programming with threads. So I could go on about the conclusions. Perhaps it's more interesting to demonstrate a little bit how this framework works. Let me see. So this is the actor editor. And I'm going to start. I'll just start a simple example first to see how this works. And I've now started a simple QT program. That's there. And this is just a slider. So yeah, it doesn't do a lot, but you can just slide these three sliders. Then I have also a simple QT program. It's just an LCD screen. Let's So, and then in here you can see both nodes are connected. And so if I change here, it's no rocket science, but at least demonstrates how this system works. Like this. So it just demonstrates very simple. So if I then show the painter screen and it would look like this. So, well, it's not completely full screen, but at least you see what's happening. Where is the mouse? So, just pull this way. You can see here are the threads. These are the ones they're painting, and they are just handing over the image data. So, so this was the painter spree, and most subjects were able to create this program.
So each painter is handing over its results to a central coordination?
Yeah. Okay. So you have the canvas actor and the painter actor.
Right. Okay.
Yeah. So I cannot show the third test because I need a specific OpenCV library and I don't have it here. It was only working on Raspberry Pis. But the Dining Philosophers problem, that's this one. There's nothing to see. Well, I can see it and show you the terminal. This one is using the waiter solution. So there is a waiter. Get the idea, right?
So again, five philosophers and one person coordinating.
Yeah, that's the way the solution. Yeah. Yeah. So this is just, I could go on demonstrating lots of stuff about this framework, but let me just get back to some of the conclusions. We have some time left for questions. So, what we could conclude from this research was there is a need a problem utilizing multiple processors, and that our proposed solution does relieve this. But also provides an approach to utilize any concurrency solution because it's still traditional programming. This framework does not alienate from existing practices, so it's also language agnostic. The solution or the framework also helps users to design concurrent programs, and this is one of the most important topics of this research, is how people design their program. This is more a conceptual or mental challenge. But this conceptual model also allows to safely enter concurrent programming. So it does not prevent concurrency conflicts because it's still traditional programming. So if you want to mess up, you can still use mutexes, their threads directly. But as long as you followed the framework, its model, then it would prevent you from making these mistakes. Of course, if you need very high performance solutions, you probably have to go low level anyway. But at least it helps. Well, as I said before, these people people we target are not computer scientists, so at least it helps them to utilize the cores of their computer. And
so the essence of the framework is to use some kind of arbiter, coordinator between parallel, concurrent.
No, it's not using a well. It's, we like to call it an orchestrator, but it's not like it's not a central point of failure. It's not the stuff is not going through the coordinator. It's just
it's emitting events. To
it's not doing stuff. Anything. It's only eavesdropping on what our program's doing. So it does not. It can influence. It can say to an actor, hey. You have to do it. You have to send your data, your signals to that actor, but actors themselves can do that as well. It's only eavesdropping on what the actors are doing, and then it doesn't influence it in any way, unless you do. So it can be an arbiter, but it's not meant to be an arbiter. We like to call it more the director. It's like in an orchestra. Everybody in the orchestra knows what to play, but you can just coordinate and orchestrate all the events. But if the orchestrator is not doing anything, the only thing that might happen is that the orchestra is not playing in sync anymore. That's perhaps, we can perhaps use that as a parallel. What we also found was that we did a previous research into distributed computing, and some of the subjects we used also were in this research. But the ones who were already familiar with distributed computing concepts, they had less trouble with dealing with the concurrent problems. So the design patterns of these programs they look alike, which is not strange because message passing is what you do on a network anyway. You send data through the network to some other system. So in that way, we are very interested in what's happening in the network field, if we can apply that to software building as well, designing programs. Especially with stuff like software-defined networking, perhaps some of the patterns we found in designing a program you could implement in network hardware, and which is also the thing what's happening in coordination languages. But yeah, I'm getting a bit too deep, I think. Then this actor editor we had. I don't know if you're familiar with visual programming, but 20 years ago I saw, at least I was taught a lot of visual programming, but I don't know, in professional fields it's faded away a bit. And I know it because you always end up with spaghetti. But in creative coding communities, visual programming is very common. And the actor editor we had was really triggering a lot of users from, like, I want to be able to create an actor using the actor editor. So really start visual programming. So there are some parallels, but yeah. We'd like to do stuff with that, but it's not the aim of this framework yet. But then again, you also have the question about how do we prevent spaghetti, and what approaches are best to visualize the program. And finally, what we also noticed is this system can enable autonomous actors. So that will be really interesting for autonomous programs like cellular automata systems, which is able, because all these actors, they exchange metadata and they can decide themselves. Right, that's a quick presentation. Any questions so far, because my time is up.
Time for one or two small questions, if you don't mind running into break.
So you have this new framework.
Yeah.
It looks a bit like CSP channels that I know, in the sense that it is message passing.
Yeah, it is message passing.
And it reminds me a lot of I have an electronic electrical engineering background, connecting inputs and outputs together. But how does this framework do anything for people to help them not have deadlocks, resource starvation, priority inversion, and all the typical problems that you have with concurrent program?
Well, not all of them. It doesn't prevent the deadlock because that's really a synchronization issue. So you can still deadlock in this system. That was happening often with the dining philosophers. So people really had to think about this, but it was very easy for them to see that their program was deadlocking because they could visualize how their program was related and where it was going wrong. So they could reason about it very easily. It does not automatically prevent that because I don't think. Well, there is there's a lot of research is being done for concurrent programming into making sure that the compiler creates a concurrent program for you. You just program your stuff, and then the compiler automatically creates threads.
Sorry to interrupt you, but why I ask is because especially these kinds of things, or this program could potentially deadlock, for instance, maybe after running for half an hour. These are the kinds of bugs or kinds of problems that make concurrent programming hard. It's not that difficult to do, say, to write a program concurrently that works 80% of the time or works somewhat, but the complexity of the kinds of bugs that you have, and the kind of design analysis that you have to do, not to have them that make it hard.
Well, what we found is that the first thing that you have to understand is that you have to design your program differently. This is the first thing you do. About the deadlock issue, that's the whole synchronization thing, and this is really a topic where the coordination languages come into place, because they create patterns I'm not sure, because I'm not the coordination language specialist, but provide more solutions to the synchronization issues. And if I go back to the actor editor, like this, this is where, in between here, is where you want to find solutions for that in the synchronization. It is between the actors.
Mm-hmm.
And coordination language, they have patterns for that. So, this framework is also built upon ZeroMQ. I don't know if you know ZeroMQ.
Mm-hmm.
They provide some building blocks for some synchronization patterns. Well, it's more talking about topologies. Mm-hmm. But it's not enough. You can still deadlock then. So, I don't have the holy grail. Unfortunately, but what I was saying is that compilers, I have a colleague that's doing really this, making sure compilers are doing it for you. But I don't believe in that solution. So, any other questions?
Yes.
I've heard it for a long time, so I'm going to say a big warm applause for you.